you find that the growth is sub-exponential growth as soon as gamma is strictly bigger than 1. And so, good news is, as soon as my kernel decays a little bit, the expected growth from the Grandval is sub-exponential. This is the expected, like, nonlinear growth. But then, I can kill this with the exponential decay coming from the linear problem. And so the nonlinear interaction will be killed with the linear thing. But now, when you look at this, you see that it misses the most important case. Gamma equals 1. So you need a more refined analysis. More refined analysis will come from not trying to estimate the norm at once, but separating the different modes and estimate them as a system, as a coupled system. And here is the baby problem that gives the right behavior. Problem which captures just like the nonlinear effects. So here the baby problem would be that I estimate phi 1, phi 2, etc. Think of phi k of t as rho hat of pk. Exponential, maybe with some exponential weight, something like lambda t plus mu k. And the system would be this. Phi k of t is bounded above by some source term, which you control, plus c t divided by k plus 1 to the power 1 plus gamma, phi k plus 1 of kt divided by k plus 1. Okay, so infinite amount of this. Here, we are looking at, if you want, the interaction between mode k and mode k plus 1. Just keeping this one, which is the strongest. And the echo, so there is resonance, so what matters most is what happens at time kt over k plus 1 if I want to understand time t. Here the t is still our good old t coming from the gradient in velocity. And here gamma comes from the coupling by the potential. Okay. Now, you see this. You assume that these guys are very good decay. And you ask, which is the growth that can occur for this guy? And you will see that phi k of t will be bounded above by, so there will be the part coming from the linear decay and a part which comes from the interaction, and it is like exponential c k t to a power alpha, with alpha equals 1 over gamma plus 2. And so here is the key thing. This is the exponent gamma, which gives you the critical regularity in this problem for the nonlinear stability. Here, this is like a fractional power. So in terms of Fourier space, this corresponds to a Gevrey regularity. And the exponent inside the Gevrey is given by gamma plus 2, gamma the strength of the decay of the potential. So, in particular, for Vlasov-Poisson, you expect with this analysis that the critical threshold in regularity is Gevrey 3. And in our paper, we hinted this as possibility. And then, Bilrossian, Masmoudi, Mouo proved that indeed Gevrey 3 is exactly where the proof breaks down. Okay. And second thing, you know, when you think what you have managed. You have managed to express the solution of the linearized problem at this stage by losing some amount of decay. And next stage, you will lose another amount of decay and another amount of decay. So it's a similar process to what happens when you are solving a PDE and losing some amount of regularity at each step. What do you do when you are in a perturbative context and you lose some amount of regularity at each step? You apply Nash-Moser scheme or Kolmogorov scheme, as was told us by Kolmogorov and Nash and the other people. So then consider this as a loss of x of decay, decay rate if you want, and put this in an iteration by Newton method. Historically, this approach was most famously used by Nash for his solution of the isometric embedding problem, and Kolmogorov for his solution of the stability of the Hamiltonian systems, the result that I recalled 2 days ago. There was a big difference between these two methods. Kolmogorov worked in analytic regularity. Nash worked in finite regularity. Nash applied the regularization technique at each step, which later became the Nash-Moser method. If you try to apply the regularization in the Kolmogorov scheme, it doesn't work, because regularizing in analytic regularity costs you crazy constants. On the other hand, the method of Kolmogorov allows to lose an infinite amount of derivatives, while the method of Nash needs a finite amount of derivatives. Here, if you think in terms of derivatives, we are losing here a fractional exponential power of derivative. Think of k as derivative in x. So the Nash-Moser method will not apply here. Regularizing would cost too much. Instead, we can use the Kolmogorov method working in this analytic regularity, or working in the Gervais regularity. And working in Gervais regularity, you can do in 2 different ways. Either directly with a norm which is applied to Gervais, or decomposing the Gervais function as a sum of analytic functions with control coefficients all the way. The second approach which we use. So here it will be a Newton method of Kolmogorov style without regularization. And this leads to the conclusion. Let me write the scheme. As the sum of the equilibrium plus h1 of txv, which is the solution of the linearized problem, plus higher order corrections. So this is the linearized, and this is the equilibrium for k. And at each step, you solve dt hn plus 1 plus v grad x hn plus 1 plus fn grad v n plus 1 plus f hn plus 1 grad v fn. Here you stop at hn. Is equal to a reminder minus f fn grad v hn. What we did here, remember, is taken care of by the characteristics method because it's a transport equation. Here is the reaction analysis that gave rise to the kernel. And here is a reminder which is quadratic. And that's, since it's very small, you handle it in the Newton method. If you try to draw a comparison between the Kolmogorov of Arnold Moser theory and the nonlinear Landau damping problem, we see that there are some big resemblances, even though this one is not obtained as the limit of this one. So this is for n finite, this is for n infinite, this is infinite dimension, this is only for finite number of degrees. And here, the parameter epsilon in the Kolmogorov method is the strength of the coupling. There was h0 plus epsilon h1. So it was the strength of how it becomes non-integrable. Here, epsilon is the strength of the non-linearity. And here comes the key catch. In Kolmogorov method, you start from a completely integrable system. In nonlinear Landau damping, you start from the linearized equation, which is like a completely integrable system because all the frequencies are decoupled. So in both things, what we have been doing is perturb a completely integrable system in some sense. Okay. Now, which is the, in Kolmogorov of Arnold Moser, the key is to study Diophantine conditions. There are these equations about the vector, the velocity vector omega, whether there is no resonance between the components. And the enemy is the possibility of resonance in the trajectories. What is a resonance? Resonance is when the characteristic period of 1 degree of freedom is in a rational, is rational with respect to the characteristic period of another degree of freedom, maybe 3/2. And here, what is the enemy? The enemy is the time resonance. That is when two different modes have been excited at certain times, and then you are considering later time, which is in rational proportion to that time, and the rational proportion corresponding to the same ratio of the two frequencies. See, it's resonances in time. And in this case, what can one see also is that there is a finite loss of regularity. The loss of regularity is determined by which is the exponent in the Diophantine condition, which tells you how non-resonant you are. Here there is an infinite loss of regularity corresponding to this fact that here we have a fractional exponential. So here you have a Sobolev regularity, and here it's a, on the contrary, Gevrey regularity that will become critical in your scheme. Okay.
So the KAM, the set is now open. Here it's open.
Yes, so that's one main difference. Here the set is open, it's a full, fully open set of neighborhoods. It comes from the fact that because here it's an evolution problem, so there is a time integral, and the time which is bad at the resonance, it will be compensated later in time by something which is better. Well, here there is no time averaging. You see, you are solving, the key in KAM is to solve the Hamilton-Jacobi equation, which is a time independent thing. So if in KAM, if you have a resonance, you just skip it. Here you go through it, and kind of it will be dealt by the rest of the resonances. take the final 10 minutes to explain about the refinement. So, the two main, most important contributions of the work certainly were first to show that there is relation between the problem of nonlinear Landau damping and the problem of the echo and the problem of Kolmogorov type problem. These three problems are related. And second, to point out that there is a critical Jeuvec regularity. I'm not saying that there are counter examples below Jeuvec regularity. Nobody knows. But I'm saying that the analysis and going into the physics as much as you can, etc., strongly suggests that Jeuvec, the certain Jeuvec exponent, is the critical. And that it's exactly this 1 over 3 for Coulomb interaction, 1 over gamma plus 2 for more regular interaction. And now let me take the last 10 minutes to explain about some refinements. The other thing is that Landau damping is a regularity problem. This was the other main insight. I mean, rather than proving that the force decays, we try to prove a global smoothness estimate, but in a norm that changes with time, because you focus on different frequencies. And this information contains the de-damping, but also more information about the structure of the solution. So now let's talk about refinements, and it will be very brief. Refinements and extensions. So the first one is that the proof of Landau damping for all data in G nu, for small data in G nu, nu between 1 and 3. Let's recall that Jeuvec, you have two ways to define it for a Jeuvec function. One is to say that the derivative of order n is like n factorial to the power n, with a constant if you want. And the other is to say that the Fourier transform is O of exponential minus lambda c k minus lambda k to the nu. These are the two ways to define a Jeuvec function. Jeuvec functions were introduced in the first half of the 20th century. One most important thing is that Jeuvec is, okay, so Jeuvec class is intermediate between C-infinity and analytic, but in several respects, it's closer in spirit to C-infinity than to analytic. First, you can do analysis with Jeuvec. You can have cutoff functions, you can localize, while no such thing exists as an analytic cutoff function. All the natural C-infinity functions that you construct are in fact in some Jeuvec class. And for instance, C-infinity function, you obtain them by, you know, how do you construct something like this? Well, using something like exponential 1 over x squared, something like this here. And this is Jeuvec type. So all the natural C-infinity functions that we use explicitly are in some Jeuvec class. And third comment is that naturally, when you have some parabolic smoothing and things like this, you will have Jeuvec regularity that will come most of the time in regularization. Sometimes you cannot prove the analytic regularity, but you can prove the Jeuvec. So for these reasons, the Jeuvray are a rather natural class. In fact, the an important input on this in this take was when I had discussion with Jeff Rausch, and he convinced me that Jeuvray really is a good class of function, and I should look whether we have some Jeuvray regularity. Second refinement and extension. There was the proof by Bedrosian, Masmoudi, based on the idea of Bedrosian, Masmoudi, of doing just one estimate in the norm in L2, of L2 time. Just L2 time, energy estimate, but really carefully designing the norm with a Fourier multiplier. With Fourier multipliers. Combining the action of the free flow and a time-dependent exponential weight. So these were all ingredients that we were using, and also the having norms with indices that depend on time. But somehow they insisted on putting all the complexity inside the choice of the norm and explain and avoiding in particular the characteristics. So this proof is purely Eulerian, no characteristics. And probably you lose some fine details, but for all purposes it is simpler to globally estimate, and you have no Newton scheme either, just a Grandval. Apart from that, the ingredients are the same in terms of the eco-analysis and the fact that the regularity shifts. Maybe I will not write the norm. I will rather now spend a few, one important thing. Let's use the paradifferential calculus of Boni. To estimate the product. Paradifferential calculus is something like when you have a function uv to estimate, you separate it by truncating u first and applying v, then truncating v and applying u, and then putting the remainder in the form of a bilinear term. And in such a way that in the remainder, you basically take care of frequencies which are the same order of magnitude for u and v. Somehow, actually, the Newton scheme is hidden in this procedure. This is a quadratic remainder term. Here, this is u is treated like source term and v is the unknown. Here, v is treated as source term and u is the unknown. So you have the same decomposition as here. You see, this would correspond to truncate the first and looking at second, truncating the second and looking at the first, and really there is some remainder term which comes again here. It was a remark by Hermander that in many applications, actually, you may replace the Newton scheme by a paradifferential calculus. The next extension, which was important